PQR Limited is one of the leading companies in the cement manufacturing industry. Right from its incorporation, it has been a subsidiary of GDP Limited, right? So PQR is a cement manufacturing industry. It has been a subsidiary of GDP. The total shareholding of GDP includes the following: Government of Puducherry and Government of Delhi each hold 19% of the paid up share capital each. So 19 plus 19, 38, no. And the government of Gujarat is holding 13.5. So 19 plus 13.5 or 38 plus 13.5. So more than 51% of the paid up share capital is held by central government, state government, partly by central or state government, or which is a subsidiary of a government company. So GDP Limited is a government company and PQR is a subsidiary of it, right? So PQR is a subsidiary of a government company. So even PQR is a government company. On 27th of August, JJ, the auditor of PQR Limited, has resigned from his post, citing personal reasons. He had forgotten to inform about his resignation to the concerned authorities. Once the auditor resigns, within 30 days from the date of resignation, he has to inform the company and ROC. And in case of a government company, you also have to inform the CNAG. Right, you also have to inform the CNAG. The casual vacancy which was created by the outgoing auditor was filled up with the appointment of FDI and Company Chartered Accountant as statutory auditor of PQR Limited. Right, so who was the outgoing auditor? JJ. And who is the incoming auditor? FDI and Company. However, few shareholders of the company raised certain objection, which was later settled without any problem. As a part of the terms and conditions of the appointment of the auditor, FDI and Company agreed to do the following: charge fees at 5% of the paid up capital plus 0.1% of the net profit of the company. Right? 10-1-1, charges or offers to charge, accepts or offers to accept in respect of his professional employment. Any fees which are based on percentage of profits or which are contingent upon the results of his finding or of such employment, except as permitted under the regulations under the Act. What are the exceptions? 8 exceptions. Receiver, liquidator, auditor of a cooperative society, valuer for direct taxes and duties, certain management consultancy services, certain fundraising services, debt recovery services, cost optimization service, any other service or audit as may be decided. However, JJ means the outgoing auditor had charged only a fee of 45,000. New auditor, what he is saying? 5% of paid up capital plus 0.1% of the net profit. And we also agreed to select and is FDI also agreed to select and recruit personnel, conduct training program for and on behalf of PQR Limited. 224, management consultancy services. Is it allowed? Select personnel recruitment. Yes, allowed. Yes, personnel recruitment selection allowed. Now, the company was having an annual turnover of 200 crore and hence it was also liable to tax audit under Section 44AB. Right. During the current financial year 1920, PQR Limited has changed its method of accounting compared to the previous year. Method of accounting clause 13 of Form 3CD and had reported a closing stock of raw material amounting to 2 lakh. So, quantitative detail, clause 30. Right, quantitative details, clause 35 of Form 3CD. Also, the company had borrowed a sum of 10 crore equally from two public sector banks and two NBFC, and it has also repaid few deposits amounting to 75 lakh to the deposit holders. So, clause 31, but this is from whom? The public sector banks and NBFC. There we only talk about the loans accepted, repaid from the related parties and person. Right, loan taken from banks, financial institution, not require reporting under clause 31. As far as FDI and Company Chartered Accountants are concerned, F, who is one of the partner of the firm, F does not sign the financials, had borrowed a sum of 3.89 lakh from GDP Limited. Right, so borrowed 3.89 lakh. He also purchased goods worth 1.09 lakh from the company. Right, so how much? Just marginally saved. And a 4.98 lakh, right, from the company, and the sum borrowed and the cost of goods bought are not yet paid by F, another partner of the firm. And I is responsible for signing the financial statements, and he was also engaged in the teaching profession during his free time. You understand, engaged in teaching profession, that is allowed. Now, upon hearing about the efficient services by FDI and company chartered accountant, they were approached by XYZ, a cooperative society, to act as their statutory auditor for the upcoming financial year. The firm agreed to the offer and had the following options in mind with respect to the fees to be charged by them. So now FDI is also being appointed to do the audit of a cooperative society, right? To charge fees as percentage of net profit or to charge fee of 101 rupees. Okay, question number one. To whom should have JJ informed about his resignation? What could be the possible consequence for his non-compliance? What is it? Is it a government company? Right, so he should have informed about his resignation to company, to ROC and also to the CNAG. Right, what does first option say? He should have informed the registrar and PQR. Okay, he should have informed registrar alone. Okay, he should have informed registrar and FDI and company. Who is this FDI and company? Incoming auditor, out, white lie, safed jhoot. What are you telling? As if we have not done a class. Okay. He should have informed the registrar and FDI and company, out. He should have informed the registrar and the comptroller. The company though is informed. Registrar and CNAG. And as a consequence of his failure, he is liable to a fine of 45,000. 50,000 or the remuneration of the auditor, whichever is less. Right, so here how much is the remuneration? See, somewhere they have said that JJ had agreed to charge fee only of 45,000. Right, so don't apply too much of mind. Anyways, you know, CNAG wala option correct hai na? So then CNAG option is correct now. So anyways, this is more in favor. You understand, it is more in favor. That is why you select D and no A, no B. Right, with respect to the acts carried out by Mr. F, the partner of the audit firm, what can you infer about the appointment of FDI and company as auditor of PQR Limited? It is valid since the indebtedness is within the prescribed limit. It is not valid since the indebtedness exceeds prescribed limit of 1 lakh, safed jhoot. How much is the limit of indebtedness? 5 lakh. Okay. It is valid since F is not signing the financial. No, it is applicable to all partners of the firm. Relative also. Person, partner, relative should not be indebted exceeding rupees 5 lakh in 5 companies. Company, holding company, subsidiary company, associate company and any other subsidiary of that holding company. It is valid since the indebtedness is not with PQR. No, it is applicable to the group. Right? So it is valid since the indebtedness is within the prescribed limit. 4.98 lakh. What is the limit of indebtedness? 5 lakh. Which among the below are permitted as per the Chartered Accountants Act? Right? Charge fee at 5% plus 0.1% of the net profit, not permitted as per Chartered Accountant Act. Select and recruit personnel, conduct training program for or on behalf of the client, permitted. And Mr. I, one of the partner who is responsible to sign financials, was into teaching profession, but it is allowed. No permission granted generally and permission to be taken specifically. So what is allowed? 2 and 3. Right? So 2 and 3. So C is the correct option. Okay, with respect to the fees to be charged for its new assignment, which option can be accepted, opted by FDI and company, you know, that cooperative society, new assignment, charge fee as percentage of net profit or 101 rupees. Right, so what does it say? Charge fee as percentage of net profit or 101 rupee, either A or B, either 1 or 2, either 101 honorary amount or percentage of net profit, cooperative society. And among the below transaction, which were undertaken by PQR Limited, which needs to be reported by the auditor under the fiscal laws. So 10 crore loan taken? No, because it is from public sector bank and the NBFC. Change in method of accounting? Yes. Repayment of deposit? No, again because it is from NBFC public sector bank. And reporting of closing stock of raw material worth 2 lakh? Yes. So 2 and 4. So B is the correct option. Next one. CA and company chartered accountant have been appointed as the auditor of ZXC company. CA and company chartered accountants have been appointed as the auditor of ZXC company. The company has obtained a license from the central government for itself to promote the sport of hockey in the rural areas of India. So they've obtained a license from CG. The company's average annual profit was estimated to be around 50 lakh. Profit around 50 lakh. This profit would not be distributed as dividend to the shareholders. However, it would be applied towards its objective of promoting the sports of hockey in the rural areas of the country. That means it is a Section 8 company. First question, it was a government company. Did you see that over there? Puducherry and that, Delhi and Gujarat. Now it is a Section 8 company. Now, during the course of the audit for 1920, the following observations with respect to the company were made by the auditors. The company was not maintaining proper records with respect to fixed assets maintained by it. The value of the fixed assets amount to 1.5 crore approximately. Clause 1A. Whether the company is maintaining the proper record showing full particulars including the quantitative details and the situation of fixed assets. Physical verification for the same was not carried out at regular interval. The last verification was done on 31st of July. So physical verification, has it been conducted at reasonable interval, and any material discrepancies noticed on physical verification, have they been properly dealt with in the books of account? And because I have come to Caro, okay, there is 1A, 1B and there is 1C. What is 1C? Title deeds of immovable properties. Are they held in the name of the company? If not, provide the details thereof. Right? Title deeds of immovable properties. This is the blue color sunglass. Type. This is what you need to report. Title deeds of immovable properties. Are they held in the name of the company? If not, then provide the details thereof. So title deed means I need to check the sales deed. I need to check the transfer deed. I need to check the conveyance deed. I need to check the lease deed. And these deeds I need to reconcile with the FAR. I need to reconcile with the list of immovable properties in the fixed assets register. So in fixed assets register, 30 land and building. I want 30 title deeds. And all 30 title deeds should be in the name of the company. This is the audit procedure. You keep it in your mind. Blue color sunglasses, remove. Then wear green color sunglasses. Audit procedures. Right, so say check the title deeds, reconcile with the fixed assets register. Sometimes there could be a situation where there could be an amalgamation. So in that case, the property might be in the name of the earlier entity. Sometimes it could be a conversion of a LLP or a firm into a company. In that case, the property would be in the name of the LLP. Are you understanding? Sometimes the property could be mortgaged with the bank for a loan. In that case, you need to obtain a confirmation from the financial institution. And a land and building, you could have mortgaged it with the bank for a loan. So now it is not going to be in your name. It is going to be in the name of the bank financial institution. So what audit procedure? One exam, they ask this case study. Right, in that case you need to obtain the confirmation. Sometimes the property title deed could be destroyed. And by fire, flood, earthquake. Right? In that case, you need to make the inquiries of the management. Sometimes they could be lost. In that case, you need to check whether an FIR has been filed. Sometimes there could be a dispute regarding the ownership of the property. So in that case, again, you need to make the inquiries of the management. If you see Caro in your book, you'll see a table over there. No, on the left hand side, the reporting requirement is given. Then what is given on the right hand side? All the audit procedures. Okay, what checking is to be done? How the verification is to be done? Anyways, what is that? Clause 1. Yes, what is 1C? Title deeds of immovable properties. Are they held in the name of the company? If not, provide the details thereof. So this one is trending. No, right now 1C. Right, trending. Title deeds of immovable properties. Anyways, let's come back to this question. What did this question say? First, it is a Section 8 company. Second, we found some points for Caro. Now, third, as a result of the observation, the auditor decides to report the same in Caro. However, the management of the company was against the decision of the auditor and insisted that the observation need not be reported. After several discussions, the CA and company decided not to report on the issues. Next one, CA and company chartered accountant were also acting as the auditor for another company, LS Limited and KD Bank Limited. During the course of LS Limit, audit of LS Limited, there was a difference of opinion between the management and the auditor as to which among the following are the areas which the auditor should take into account to determine key audit matters as per SA 701. Effect on the audit of significant transaction that took place, areas of higher assessed risk as high risk as assessed and reported by management's expert, what they are writing, you know, drafting error. Where they got this from? I'll tell you how to determine key audit matters. Only 3 points over there. Areas of higher assessed RMM, significant auditor judgment involved, and the effect on the audit of any significant event or transaction that took place during the year. Right. So third one, significant auditor judgment relating to the areas in the financial. Right. So second one, they've done a drafting error over there. Right. During the audit of KD Bank, the auditors and the management had a certain difference of opinion as to the amounts and the items which need to be disclosed under the head of contingent liability. They say, we don't know what is coming under contingent liabilities of bank and what is not coming. That is one problem. However, apart from that, the auditors observed the following. What did he observe? 59 agricultural loan account guaranteed by government of Delhi amounting to 29 lakh were overdue for more than 2 years. 73 guaranteed by government of India agricultural loan account amounting to 25 lakh were overdue for more than 2 years. And 6 corporate loan account guaranteed 3 each by government of India and government of Delhi amounting to 25 lakh for each company were overdue for more than 3.5 months. On hearing about the FE, so that is over. LS Limited, key audit matter question. KD Bank Limited, the advances ka question. Now, on hearing about the efficient services provided by CA and company, chartered accountant, they were offered the following new assignment. A GST assessing officer approached for conduct of special audit under section 66 of the CGST Act for a company named MD Limited, which was having an annual turnover of 1 crore. He had requested for the special audit as per the opinion that the company had not availed the input tax credit within the normal limit. A GST assessing officer, right, offered to provide incorporation services to RS General Insurance Limited. Now, insurance company, integrated case study. What is the case study? Integrated case study. Okay, which was proposed to be paid, set up with paid up share capital of 113 crore, of which preliminary expenses of 17 crore were included. The audit firm, after taking into consideration all the facts and figures with respect to these new assignments, GST audit and insurance audit, decided not to undertake both of them. Right. Is the decision of CA and company of not reporting the issue of ZXC in Caro 2016 justified? If so, under what reason? It is a Section 8 company. To Section 8 company, Caro only not applicable. Hence, there is no question of reporting. Right. Caro is applicable to ZXC? No. Yes, Caro is not applicable to ZXC and hence the same need not be reported. Why? It is a Section 8 company. Right, so Caro only not applicable. So the question of reporting does not arise. Look at what they write ahead. Now, no, as per SA 240, the auditor has to maintain professional skepticism when it comes to the issues in the area of fixed asset and hence the same has to be reported. Yes, as per SA 320, materiality, the auditor after taking into account materiality of the issue, he may either choose to report or not to report upon the same. It requires a lot of creativity to create the wrong options. What is the total amount of loan that should be classified as NPA by KD Bank? 79, 100, 204 and 104. Right, we studied now central government guaranteed advances and state government guaranteed advances. So this is government of India. So this is not to be taken. Right, now 6 corporate loan accounts guaranteed 3 each by government of India. So these 3 of government of India not to be taken. And government of Delhi amounting to 25 lakh each. So 25 into 3, 75. And first one, government of Delhi, 29. So 75 plus 29, 104 lakh. Right, the 25 plus the 75 plus the 29, that is the 104 lakh. We studied, no, central government guaranteed advances need not be treated as an NPA till the time the central government does not repudiate the guarantee when invoked. However, that does not apply to the state government guaranteed advances. So 104 lakh. Which among the following has to be reported by the auditor as a contingent liability of KD Bank? Guarantee given by KD Bank on behalf of constituent located in Myanmar, a percentage of the total bills purchased by KD Bank, claims against the bank acknowledged as debt, an unpaid salary of 5 lakh to 5 staff who are currently undergoing a court trial. Now, unpaid salary is not a contingent liability, it is a provision. Claims against the bank not acknowledged as debt is a contingent liability. Acknowledged as debt is again a provision. Percentage of total bill, we don't have anything like that. Right? So, what is a contingent liability? Guarantee given by KD Bank on behalf of constituent account holder located in Myanmar. Right. What could be the possible reason for not accepting the special audit under section 66? Such audit is applicable only if the turnover exceeds 2 crore. Such audit needs to be conducted by cost accountants. No, no. Such audit has to be called upon by assistant commissioner. Okay. Assistant commissioner can call, but it requires prior approval of the commissioner. And such audit has to be called upon by central government. Ouch. You understand? So now 50-50 KBC done. That always happens. The A, B, C, D, B and D gone. Now such audit is applicable only if the turnover of the company exceeds 2 crore. That is not the criteria for special audit, right? So such audit has to be called upon by the assistant commissioner after the prior approval of the commissioner. Okay. Whether CA and company are justified for not accepting the incorporation services for RS General Insurance Limited? If so, as to what is the reason? Yes, the incorporation services for an insurance company should be done by auditor appointed by CNAG. No. The insurance company should have a minimum paid up share capital of 100 crore which shall exclude the preliminary expenses. Yes. No, the insurance company should have a minimum paid up share capital of 100 crore which also includes the preliminary. No. And yes, the incorporation services for an insurance company should be done by an auditor appointed by the IRDA, white lie. Okay, so which is the correct option? B. Yes, the insurance company, are they justified in not accepting the audit? Yes, because the insurance company should have a minimum paid up share capital of 100 crore which shall exclude the preliminary expenses. Okay, right, so these are the MCQs in your RTP May 20.